buildings. You can stay there. And actually, I've been on vacation. I mean, the best thing to do.
Wonderful. Did you guys meet young people? We're making community. All right. So we are going to begin. And I've had about, I don't know, three or four people ask for my personal story about how I got to do what I do. And Kristen wants me in the film, which I'm a little tenuous about.
Stand on this side of the screen.
And so I will give you either the short to long version about how I got here. This picture you are going to love. Except for now we're off of that. Huh. Hi, babe. All right. Did it work? Here I am at 6 years of age. This is my next picture. In this picture, that's my father standing up in the boat, and I'm the one with the long dark hair and the blue shirt. My sister's the one with the red head turning the other way. And so one of the things I want to bring to your consciousness tonight is something called the field effect. Has anybody here heard of the field effect? Yeah, awesome. So there's a really incredible book, if you are a geek, by Lynn McTaggart called The Field, that talks about the quantum physics and science behind the field effect. So as opposed to just giving you my minute speech about being a chiropractor and how I became a chiropractor, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the field I was soaked in, okay? This man, my father, is a really wonderful, amazing person. My mother, also a really amazing, wonderful person. It's really strange to be 50 years of age and feel like nobody else ever says that about their parents. Mm-hmm. I have amazing parents. They're incredible. And the field that they raised me in was magnificent because both my mother and my father came from a pretty serious trauma. So, is it possible that people do their menus and then pass it down so that we're not talking while it's happening?
Sure.
Can everybody just make sure to check your menus and then pass it down to the end? Tom, will you raise your hand? Pass it that way.
Are we supposed to put our name on this board or just circle?
I'm not sure. Emily, who's our server?
Just circle.
Hey, Rob, is it okay if we pass the menus down so that I'm not talking over you?
Okay.
Or do you not know where they are if we do it that way?
Which menus are you speaking of? The
ones that you're checking right now, can they just hand them all to you?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Cool, but then do you know who has what?
We're supposed to put
I need to go around and mark the seat number so when the food comes out, it's all those.
Okay, so keep it with you. Sorry. But if you cannot talk, that would be helpful. Okay? So, I'm coming back to my parents. So, a lot of times people kind of get triggered by my parents' story. And I'm saying that in a reason because that's one of the things I want to talk about tonight. So, my father escaped the Holocaust at the age of 6. And came over from Czechoslovakia to here, lost a lot of his family in Auschwitz. And my mother has a similar story. Her father died because of a lack of penicillin, believe it or not. And all of her family was raised in an orphanage. So both of my parents had incredible traumas. And the part that's incredible about my parents is they took those traumas and used them for personal growth. Their entire life, the culture I was steeped in was about service. So what they learned is, my gosh, life is hard. How do I help other people out of this intense pain, right? Here's a list of all the jobs I've held. You'd be hard-pressed to not, to go to war with me with all the different jobs I've had in the world. What people may or may not know is that the three that were most defining besides my parents was I was a school teacher. I taught at a private Jewish school for about 4 years, and then I decided that that was too hard. I was 22, and I wanted to go back to my dance career, and I became a construction worker. so that I could pay my bills. And sure enough, guess what I did?
You hurt your back.
I hurt my back. I was the only woman in my union. I was a hod carrier, for those of you who are old enough to know what that is. I carried cement for a living, and I hurt my back. So I decided to go to a chiropractor. The chiropractor taught me this incredible technique called applied kinesiology, an SOT, which is magnificent at fixing people. So I go to chiropractic school, and I think I'm going to learn how to fix people naturally without drugs or surgery, and I'm so excited. And then I lost the love of my life, and I was devastated. So I had emotional trauma. And somebody said, hey, try this network spinal. I'm like, that stuff is crazy. It's very different and woo, I don't know. I got on the table, my life changed. Literally, overnight. The emotional trauma turned into personal growth. So tonight, what I want to tell you about is how we get there. This is a little bit different. My father, okay, Father's Day, I call my father. Happy Father's Day, Dad. You have to understand, my father's a medical doctor. He's a brilliant man, but we don't always see eye to eye on Western medicine versus alternative medicine, right? I'm talking to him, and he says to me this: symptoms are a poetic expression of the core conflict that drives you. You have to listen to that pain, not attack it.
Wow.
I almost fell over. I'm like, this is the man who takes medications every time he's sick. Every single time. Right? But go back to that core wound that I was telling you about that I was raised in. Look what he's done. He took his core pain and transformed it into personal transformation. I am not joking when I say he's helped over 2 million people out of poverty. 2 million. That's phenomenal. Why? Because he had a wound that he used for personal transformation. So what I hope to talk about in 20 minutes, which is kind of shocking, is how we do that, okay? So without further ado, I give you the 5 gifts of the spine. I like those little transitions. They entertain me. So the 5 gifts of the spine are function, emotion, sense of self, behavior, and consciousness. When you come to my office, you're going to notice that my office is really different than a traditional chiropractor's office. Why? Because I do these other 4 things besides just function. Right? Traditionally speaking, when you go see a chiropractor, the major thing you're thinking about is function. How is my body working? So let's start with that. Emily handed out to every single one of you this chart. Has everybody gotten a chance to look at it briefly? And then just because I also have that performance art background with my construction days, we assigned you a vertebra. Why? Because with my teaching days, I know that if I ask you to read that whole chart, you won't. If I ask you to pay attention to C1 or whatever the vertebra is that's on your tag, you'll learn at least that one vertebra. Okay? In this picture, which, you know, is too small for a slide, but you will see that there's green and yellow. Can everybody see that, kind of?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So sympathetic is yellow. What is the sympathetic nervous system? Anybody want to give it a shout out? Fight, flight, right? Parasympathetic is?
Rest and digest.
Rest and digest, right? So what we want to look at if we're trying to optimize the nervous system is turning up the sympathetic or turning up the parasympathetic?
Parasympathetic,
right? So the beginning of care, we call discover care, we're looking at how can we turn up the parasympathetic. And it's not just a notion. We also want to know what organs it goes to. So for instance, one of the things that people always say is parasympathetic is in charge of, does anybody have any guesses?
Digestion.
Digestion, right? They also, it's in charge
healing.
Of, say it again?
Healing.
Healing. So what is the best hours for healing, if we're looking at it that way?
Sleeping,
rest. So that's why sleep is so important. But also heart can be parasympathetic, smooth muscle, digestion, right? And when we study yogis or people who meditate a lot, we notice that you can actually change the heart rate. So these are important things that you want to know about sympathetic, parasympathetic. So when we're looking at the structure of the spine,
the first thing that people think about with chiropractic is neck pain, back pain, headaches, sciatica, carpal tunnel, right?
That's structure. There are over 700 types of chiropractic. In traditional structure, what we're looking at is how do we fix the structure so that that pain is gone? Do you remember back to what my dad said? Right? If I remove that pain, then do I get the gift that's behind it?
No.
Right? So what we look at in most medicines, even alternative medicines, is if you pull out the symptom and you get rid of it, then you don't get the gift behind it. So what we're looking at is these are the lists of things that we most often talk about. These are the things that we're talking about when we're talking about, I want to get rid of my XYZ LMNOP. But really there is so much more. So if you want to look at that chart, at least memorize the one that you have. I may test you on it. Or I may get to be a performance artist and have you line up and do a little spinal dance. We'll see. So chiropractors, which I am trained in, believe the central nervous system is the master system. Since then, with quantum mechanics and quantum physics, we have learned that there is much more than that. But if we go back to the mechanistic understanding, it's the master system that controls every cell, tissue, and organ in the body. It's made up of your brain, spinal cord, and a network of 12 miles of nerves. The most important part I want you to pay attention to is 10% of these nerves register pain. When is it that people come into the office? Pain. Is that the best time to come into the office?
Maybe not.
Maybe not. Right? Maybe we want our digestive system to work. Maybe we want our heart to work. Maybe we want a more holistic vision of health. We don't want to wait till we get to the 10%. When you get to the 10%, guess what your body is doing? Hey, stupid! I told you and told you and told you and you didn't listen. So now I'm going to scream. Right? And then people say, always. I'm sorry, you guys, but this is a pet peeve. I slept wrong. Really? Are you sure about that? So when your body's screaming at you, what are the three reasons that we hold tension in the nervous system? My practice members who've been with me forever, I will be horribly disappointed if somebody doesn't say these.
Stress.
Stress, emotions. What else? Come on, the obvious.
Bad luck.
I appreciate that. Bad luck. Physical. So, car accident, fall down the stairs.
Injuries.
Physical, emotional, and then the third one is biochemical. What biochemical is anything that changes your biochemistry. So if I live next to these gorgeous grape fields, what am I exposed to? Yeah, right? So all three of those things will create tension or pain pattern. It's not all just physical. We got to start thinking bigger, okay? This is just fun. I'm geeking out with you guys. I can't help it. I'm a nerd.
This is a cut through a cadaver.
Alfred Grigg was a man who studied cadavers at the wazoo. And what he learned is that when the nervous system is under high amounts of tension, it creates stress on the nerves and to all the matching organs.
Which one is a natural curve? This one or this one, if you had to guess. A or B?
A.
Natural curve.
This is the stressed body, right?
Loss of the cervical neck curve, the arc of life, stretches the spinal cord 5 to 7 centimeters and produces pathological tension, putting the body into a state of disease. Now, this is an MD from the 50s saying this.
This is not, you know, Donnie or somebody like that, okay? I want to show you in the body. If I'm in fight or flight, tell me which body position is this tension pattern. This or this? I heard that.
The first one
is which?
Tension.
Tension, right? So here comes my neck. Oh, shucks, it's coming up. So we're still on function, okay? If you want to read, because you're a readings like kind of person, which I'm not, that is everything I just said in a slide. So I will skip to the next one. I'm going to skip to this one and we'll go back, although I'm scared I will never be able to go back.
Oh,
no. Loss of cervical nerve. Right? Are we familiar with this? And the one that makes me kind of nuts these days, sorry, pushing my back, is this one, right?
Yes.
Can you see the loss of cervical nerve? And we're talking about hours on end. It's really intense.
Okay, moving backwards.
I have found in my history as a teacher and as a presenter that people like stories. So I'm going to tell you this story. It's a weird one, but it's my favorite. So one of my favorite case studies was a 30-year-old woman who flew here to Sebastopol because we have so much alternative medicine here. She had been sick for years and years and years, and she came here to have the natural healers heal her. At the point that I met her, she had been in her bedroom for 2 weeks at a time. She had to have all the windows darkened like this. She couldn't cook for herself. Her mother had to fly out and feed her, drive her to her appointments. The mother couldn't be with her grandchildren. The mother couldn't be with her husband for 2 years. She sits down in the office. I take a case study. And I say, what's going on? She says, I'm sitting here talking to you. And then all of a sudden, I do this. I said, oh, okay. So they're diagnosing you with what? Anybody have an idea? If I'm like this, and then I just go like this.
We can't barely see you.
Okay, you don't move. Yeah. You just pause. They had diagnosed her with seizures and had her on intense epileptic seizure medication. I said, that's great. I'm glad that you have a diagnosis. Can you tell me what happens when you go away? And she says, well, I go away. I'm just in the middle of a conversation. I go away, and I go to this room, and there's bright white light, and there's a table, and there's six people sitting at the table there. I said, great. Have you talked to any of those people? She said, no. I said, okay, there's your homework. So she went away. She had this experience again. She talked to the people at the table, and she realized that it was a spiritual awakening. And that these were guides for her. And within 3 months, she was out of her house, she was cooking for herself, and she became a healer. So why am I telling you this particular story? Sometimes when we look at function and we just try to change the function so that the person can go back to the way their life was meant to be, it's not meant to be that way. The pain is there for a reason. The pain is to wake you up to move forward. So finding out what that pain is and what it's projecting you towards is what we're looking at, okay?
We saw this, we can skip this.
Now, as we start to move through the next series of slides, we're moving up out of the traditional vein of chiropractic. In traditional chiropractic, we're only looking at function. As we work with you in network spinal, we move through different stages of consciousness. The next stage of consciousness is emotion, okay? If you think about it this way, when I'm in pain, who am I thinking about? Yourself. Everything's about you. People who are in intense pain have very little room to see anybody besides themselves, right? When we get to this level, we're looking at emotion. It's interesting to me, a lot of people show up in my office with about 6 emotions. If you want some homework to play with at home, write down the emotions you most commonly feel in a day. I'm always impressed when people come up with like 6, under 10. I go, wow, that's not a very wide range of experience. The point of emotion is to take energy and put it into motion. So close your eyes for a moment. I want you to think about a time in your life that was really awful. Something horrible happened that you wished had. And I want you to think about the emotions that went with that. Then once you have that, I want you to project 2 years past that moment. Then go ahead and open your eyes. If you were able to do that exercise in that short amount of time, when you projected 2 years past, were you happy with what the emotion caused you to change? No. Raise your hand if you're a yes. Raise your hand if you're a no. Okay, so about 50-50. Okay? So usually what emotion is there for is to catalyze change. We use emotion to change things. When we don't do that, we just end up in suffering. If we stay in suffering, we don't move from discover, this place of it's all about me, I'm wounded, I'm Eeyore, to a place of I'm going to move forward in my life. So there are things to think about. People ask me how this has anything to do with posture. Isn't that cute?
I love that picture because
people say to me, well, my posture is bad because of my structure. Are you sure about that? If this person's yelling at you, what happens to your posture? Right? So that's an emotional response to posture. Let's play. What's this person feeling?
Introverted.
Frustration.
Mm-hmm.
Sadness. So people say to me all the time, Laura, emotion in the spine, how can you tell that there's emotion in the spine? I don't think it's that hard to tell what's happening here, right? We read body language all the time. How about this picture? Okay, great. I mean, you guys all in here all giggling.
We know exactly how he's feeling.
Give me some words. Right? Okay, so just try this in your own bodies for a minute. Everybody go like this. Now try to say woohoo. Right? It's almost impossible. So go like this and go, I'm mad as hell and I hate you. It just doesn't work. So people ask me, well, but wait, emotion in the spine? You see it, right? Next state of consciousness. Get it? The fractured sense of self? Do you want me to do it again?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I can. So here we are with emotions. Sense of self.
Thank you.
So after emotions, and if you look at children and child development, we also start to see that people evolve in these levels of consciousness, right? So the next state is sense of self. Who am I? What am I in relationship to the world? How do I know this? What does it take?